we doing this Tuesday? Let's see, what time is it? It's 1:50. And the best thing about quarantine life and keeping, being guardian of the baby and making sure that she stays healthy and COVID free is I kind of have the free time to cook and do whatever my mind feels like. And I got on this mental tangent about how overrated chicken and waffles is again. Like, in my own self, I debated it. And I thought about the things that people have done to consider themselves innovative with chicken and waffles. I mean, but in the end, it really is, no matter what you do to it, you can change the flavor of the waffle. Like, I've seen people do red velvet cake waffles and, you know, a fried chicken. When I first moved back to Huntsville in 2014, there was a chef that thought that his chicken and waffles was innovative because he sous vide it. I was like, okay, yeah, sous vide is a new technique, but it really doesn't change the flavor of the chicken, blah, blah, blah. But in the end, it was still a battered and fried piece of chicken once you pulled it out of sous vide. You know, so in my mind, I've always tried to find a way for chicken and waffles to not just be a waffle and a piece of chicken. Like, come on, y'all. Like, we can do something smarter than that. One time, a chef friend of mine, we worked together a lot. Shout out to Chef Allen Noble with No Chefs. But had to get credit where credit was due on that one. Me and him worked together on a brunch, and it was his brunch. And we had discussed the idea of chicken battered in a waffle breading. And I did a waffle breading with that one, and we oven roasted that one. I've made like pancake, well, the waffle batter, and done a nice pound chicken tender, and fried the chicken tender in the waffle like that, and waffle breading like that. But still, you know, in the end, as much as you go from that, that's just still like, it's just a sweetened piece of chicken at that point. It's, you know it's waffle breading because I told you, but that could have just been any sweet breading at random. So in an effort today, in a random thought, debating myself in my mind, how can chicken and waffles not just be a piece of the chicken beside a waffle? Again, as you can see, my chicken today is leftover Popeyes. Love it! Honey, yes, okay. One of my favorite stops used to be, it's not in the same spot no more. But when I used to come home from Charlotte, North Carolina, because there was it was Bojangles country in North Carolina. So like the Popeyes was like hard to find. Charlotte was like a Popeyes desert, bro. Like, we don't even want to talk about how hard it was for Popeyes. Because Bojangles, Sean like Popeyes. Tag me on that. Bojangles, show a Popeyes. The biscuits still dry, but they ain't Popeyes. But anyway, off on a Popeyes tangent. Coming in a drive from North Carolina, the first stop that I knew I was home was that Popeyes on the corner of North Memorial Parkway and Master Lake Road. And boy, you hit that Popeyes right there. Not Master Lake Road. Lord, y'all, I got off Thomas. They done moved it to Master Lake Road over there. That's why I said Master Lake Road. But it was North Memorial Parkway and Sparkman Drive. Let's see. I think that's enough chicken for what I want to do. I might make two of them. Just let me pull out some more chicken. Just in case this don't work the first time. We gonna make sure I got enough chicken. because this is an experiment. This is like playground time. Y'all play with me here. It's gonna be interesting. The fruit I got out, I got some berries left over from, they're frozen. So I'm gonna make a mixed berry syrup, waffle bread, and waffle iron heating up. But anyway, as y'all can see, the first step in this experiment of today, chicken and waffles. It's not just chicken. I mean, think about it though. Even if you did like a barbecue smoked piece of chicken, instead of your traditional fried chicken, like if you did a barbecue smoked chicken, then you'd have to go with a savory waffle. So maybe like a cornbread, corn mealy type waffle that's not so sweet, that wouldn't counterpart and clash so much with the smoky flavor. So even if, you know, that may be innovative if you did that. Like smoked chicken and waffle, yeah, that would be, yeah. I like that. Yeah, I'm gonna think about that one too. See what I'm saying? Yeah, think about it. Cause you know, in the end, when it's just, I mean, however many years ago, what was it, the 70s? So 50 years ago, it was brilliant. Today, everybody done 30 which ways from Sunday, Monday and Tuesday. And I'm finna try something different today that I ain't never seen and I ain't never done. Y'all seen somebody else do this random nonsense, you let me know and tell them they innovative, okay? They smart, they brilliant, because right now we're gonna have fun. We're gonna play for some food. Chicken and waffles with the mixed berry. Ooh, I got pecans in there. With a mixed berry syrup. Yeah, we're gonna do that today.
All right, what I'm doing right now is I'm breaking up these berries in Fireball. I wanna put a little bit of that cinnamon flavor into these. And you know how I feel about cooking with alcohol. It's just a little more fun that way. So I'm breaking these berries up just because they were frozen. And I want to go ahead and let it, and this liquor was ice cold. So I want to go ahead and just kind of let them not have to work so hard, let the heat work so hard. Smaller surface area here, people. This is science. These small and broken up berries will heat up and cook faster than them big old frozen ones. So a little manual labor right here before I turn it on. And it's already starting to create a bit. Where are you guys? There you guys are. It's already starting to create a bit of a natural syrup. The Fireball is already starting to turn that color of the berries. So this is going to be a soft flame here because alcohol is volatile. So when cooking with liquor, don't be up here raging the heat and doing something you don't know. If you've not experienced with cooking with gas and cooking with alcohol, do not blow your eyebrows off trying to do something you just seen on the internet, because Marquita make it look so easy. Marquita's done practiced the flambe. You don't know how many times in my life I have had to flambe. So don't be out there on the first time on your gas stove just trying to go, ooh, look, it's easy. Woo, woo. You bending down, you done caught your hair on fire. That's human hair you got on. It's expensive. It done burned up. Same thing, y'all out there, natural ladies, afros, dreadlocks, kinky twists. I always know what my hair is. Don't catch yourself on fire trying to do something you see me do. You hear me now? Hallelujah. All right, I'm going to let it get a little more excited. And what I want the alcohol to do is I want it to reduce and thicken. If make that first initial syrup, okay? You guys, make it sexy, but don't overpower this, bro. Like, if I flambé now, I really wouldn't get any of that whiskey flavor. So I'm trying to control the heat and let the berries go on and get that. Let that work and get it on the inside. And remember, people, like I said, please don't set yourself on fire. I'm not going to bother to strain this. I know chefs, there's some chefs out there that are probably going to say something about the seeds in the end. But no, I'm having an experiment with flavors. You know what I'm saying? And when you're playing around in the playground, yeah, you skip some of the steps for aesthetics. And then other days you don't. This was one of those playground moments where if you were going to imitate this, once I got done and got this maybe to a nice puree and got this broken down, I'd actually I don't know. It's just not worth it. It's worth the effort. It is totally worth the effort to strain the seeds, but just not today. But strain the seeds, I'ma say that. Once I got this flambéed and I'ma add more water back to it to bring it back up, I would strain it then and then cook it down with the sugar. That is where I would strain it, because I wouldn't want to strain it when it was too thick. I'd want to strain it when it was most thin so I don't lose any product. So 2 steps from now, I'll mention the idea of straining again and where I would decide to stop and strain if I felt like straining today. Ooh, I got it burning. I'll see pretty. Yeah. Okay, so you notice if I added aluminum foil down here. Now this is gonna protect my surface again from a sticky mess. You can't take the line cook out of me, y'all. So I'm gonna turn this heat up now that I got it back going and back together. Now this water is already hot, just because I don't want to shock what I got going on here. It is a messy day for mama. I was thinking about using 2 cups of water, but it looked like 1 cup gonna do. Yep, and I'm gonna leave it at 1 cup of water, hot. Then again, if we talk about straining, I would say somewhere around in this step, once I got it back up, and I would cook it definitely a few more minutes to break up any more fruit pulp that is around these seeds, because I don't want to lose the opportunity to collect some more flavor. But for the most part, I've probably gotten it all out between the cooking down into the alcohol and the caramelization and in the flambe. So I've probably gotten it all out, and at this point, this is just for good measure. We're going to boil the life of it. You know how I love to do things, just for good measure. How I like doing things for good measure. A few more berries. You know, just because it ain't berry enough for me. For good measure, I didn't think that this was berry enough. So I gave it another good hit of berries. And again, this is why I said I ain't worried about straining it. Because you know how things may change. And I'm actually liking the texture. The contrast and texture between the larger berries and the bigger berries. So I'm gonna leave these bigger, and I'm gonna just let them, if they fall apart, they fall apart. If they don't, they don't. I think for presentation's sake, some of those big pieces of berry is going to be quite nice. And at this point, it's just finishing a simple syrup to your liking. Y'all know my friends, rum extract. Ooh, that got it excited. Hope you saw it happen, I did. It smells so good. And it's friend vanilla. Like rum extract gives the best buttery note. I swear it does. It gives off more buttery notes than rum. And that's why I like it with vanilla. It makes vanilla round. It makes her big girl. I mean, and vanilla already ain't skinny. I mean, the bean is. But it just makes it, I don't know, it gives it a little more umami. Umami is the phrase that I'm looking for. Now, at this point, again, it's just making a simple syrup. To your liking of sweetness. Now, don't forget to salt this, because even with a sweet dish, you need to add salt. Salt is a flavor enhancer, okay, you guys? Get rid of these side spoons. Salt is going to bring out everything that's naturally in it, okay? So even in baking, even in pastries, even in sweet things, you need a pinch of salt, okay? Let's not miss the purposes of salt. Now, if you get to this point and it's the desired sweetness that you like, because that was the first 1/4 cup to 1 cup here, you can thicken it with a cornstarch slurry. Just a small one. I would say maybe like a teaspoon maybe of cornstarch, teaspoon of water, and just hit it lightly, just to thicken it up. You can finish it with actual butter too. If you want to be fat, I'm not going to be fat, but I do need to taste that. And y'all might see a cornstarch slurry. I do them a lot. I prefer them over roux, and roux wouldn't be appropriate at this point anyway. Not for this. Y'all know how I feel about that measurement. I talk about it. I go a little less than the half a cup. I go a quarter cup plus an eighth. Y'all do that. Y'all do that math, okay? because I think that is the proper sweetness thing. I'm gonna let that thicken come reduce just a wee bit more. And the one thing you do need to know, though, with homemade syrups is that while they're hot, they are a lot thicker than what they're going to be, of course, with anything with sugar cool. So once this cools off, I'm not going to tighten it up too much because I don't want it to become snot. So I'm going to go ahead and kill the heat in that. And now we have our mixed dairy syrup to go on these chicken and waffles. All right, so guys, remember the key to a cornstarch slurry is to add the liquid to the cornstarch. This is about a tablespoon. I know I said a teaspoon, but about a tablespoon of cornstarch. The liquid is just to loosen the cornstarch, so you don't need a lot of liquid to cornstarch ratio here. Just enough so that it is fluid, you know what I'm saying? So that it moves, so that it's smooth. Not like you making a whole roux. If I fill this bowl up with water, that just means more water to cook down. So just enough cornstarch, usually about a 1-to-1, a little over, to make it a nice fluid, you know? So, also, when you're thickening hot liquids with the cornstarch doesn't magically thicken it. You do need to let it activate with the heat. So, once I stir in my cornstarch, it's going to take a second. So, it may alter the color a little bit, but once this comes back up to a boil and the cornstarch does do its thing, the heat is what's going to give me the thickening power. Now, again, this is a syrup, so I know that this is also going to be a lot thinner hot than I needed to be colder, so I'm not going to make it too juicy. And I'm going to just leave this on a simmering heat so that what cornstarch is in there can do its thing. And while I make this chicken and waffle concoction, as you can see now that the heat is already started to activate. And I just want it a little thicker. I don't want it runny across my waffle here. Listen, guys. I know y'all already know how to make waffle batter off of the pancake box. So, but one thing that I like to do, and there was a chef, I'm not gonna call her out, Miss Fake It Till You Make It. If you know, I ain't even gonna give you details of where I used to work because you're gonna figure her out. But a little bit of baking powder in with your little waffle batter. Make it all nice and fluffy, honey. Same thing with them pancakes. She had one of the best brunches in town, honey. Smacking brunch. The only thing real about that restaurant was her. All right. But anyway, I ain't gonna talk shit. I might even edit that out. No, I ain't. It is what it is. Not all of us are good chefs. Not all chefs are created equal. And that's why I always warn y'all about being careful about who y'all eat from social media. So that part, and you know, just know that if you ever see me eating from someone from social media, know that I know that they can cook and I know that they house clean, if it's not a standing restaurant, and know that. So if I do recommend somebody like that, go on and trust them to eat that. But that being said, even the ones that got standing restaurants, sometimes out there faking the whole funk. So, but this was one of the most brilliant things I got from a fake it the funker. And I usually throw the baking powder in with the dry mix just to give it a little more bubbles. And let it stand like the box says for about 4 to 5 minutes. But this will give you a nice fluffier waffle, fluffier pancake also. A little bit of baking powder in the batter.
Guys, I just had one of those why not moments. Click, 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 where'd I put it? Why not moments. While I'm waiting on those few minutes for the air bubbles to, see, wrong switch like a DJ, y'all. I set the wrong damn fire. I swear to God. Okay. Anyway. While I'm waiting those few minutes for those bubbles, those extra bubbles that I've just added into my waffle mix to do their thing and to sit a few minutes. I know. This is why big girl ain't losing weight, y'all. You see this? I'm finna take some pecans. I want some texture in it. I don't want a flat waffle here. Well, you know, that's the one thing that's important, key, when you're thinking about plating or even when you're creating a menu in general. I want you to think about texture and contrast in the mouth. You don't want a flat meal. Do you understand what I'm talking about, people here? Where you got mashed potatoes, macaroni and cheese, and then something else mushy, you know. I don't know, a piece of fish that has no crisp, it's baked, it's soft. And so that sounds really delicious for old people. I mean, if you're cooking for toddlers, like a lot of my food that I cook nowadays doesn't have a lot of texture because she's got small teeth. But, you know, when you're cooking for the masses, think about that. Think about bite and crunch and whether it's stringy, whether it's chewy. And do different textures with your plating. Don't be afraid to add nuts. Don't be afraid to add a breading, or even if you're going to roast, you can always bake and add breading. You just got to know how to do it right. I say it all the time, it's not what you do, it's how you do. And you can get you something baked out the oven that you could have swore was fried. But right now that's going to be, those are some brown sugar. Butter pecans. I'm not gonna put any fireball in it, but I will hit it with a little extra enhance the butter. I'm not going to salt this just because it's salt on the nuts. But don't forget, if these nuts were unsalted, I would not forget that butter component or that salt component to it. So I'm gonna give that just a few minutes. Y'all hear my baby. I get that just a few minutes. And then that is another dimension now to our chicken and waffle. All right, what you didn't see me do was I added a little bit of white sugar. And I'm gonna let that, what was gonna be a brown sugar kind of sauce is almost like an inverted caramel, and there are probably people in their mind cursing at me doing this backwards. Me too, because I didn't decide to do it until after the ingredients were in the pan. But the one thing that I love about the art of improvisation is I can fix almost anything. I sure can. So what we've got here is inverted sugar starting to caramelize in some butter. So what I'm going to do is do that.
that's gonna pull that back. What I really need to do is hit it with a whisk. Look away, people. What I'm letting the water do is going to dissolve these sugars. And then that way, when it comes back down, it'll be more of a syrup than snot. If you ever try to make something like this and you get to the point of snot, you know how to back it up, okay? And the honey's gonna help convert the sugar, the crystallized sugar back. The water's gonna bring it back. The kinetic energy and the heat's gonna bring it back. Watch it. You learn from your mistakes to improvise into something beautiful, y'all. Like I said, I've messed up on caramel so many times for improvising before that I know how to fix it when I've decided to make it after I'm full on too far in certain steps. So if you've ever gotten to the point where your sugar's over crystallized and your fat's starting to separate, go ahead and put more water back in it. Bring the heat back up and start over. And the use of honey helps convert the sugar that you need into an inverted syrup. I wish you could smell both this butter pecan syrup and this cinnamon coming off the mixed berry syrup. So they're giving me two companion smells and flavors to go with this chicken in waffle idea. And even if the in waffle part isn't a success, I feel like the outcome here is a little bit of brilliance. I'm excited about it. I'm gonna set this waffle maker up. It's been on for a while, but I turned it down. We're gonna set it to a little past light for what we need to do here. This chicken is still fairly cold. All right, let's decide what we're going to do with this chicken and waffle experiment. You can see the light from the most favorite.
because as of right now, this looks like a success. Popeyes fried chicken in waffles with a mixed berry syrup, fireball mixed berry syrup to be exact, and a butter pecan faux caramel syrup. So we're going to see if the chicken in the waffle. Mm-hmm. I mean, but who don't like not buy fried chicken? Mm-hmm. And in the end, even with the chicken in the waffle. Even with the chicken in the waffle, I can't doubt y'all good. And this fancy syrup. Woo child. It's still just. Okay, I lied. This one ain't just chicken and waffle. Thank you, Popeyes. If you like this experiment, you wanna change up brunch a little bit, hit the like button. If you on Facebook, I'm not even gonna stop eating this time. Hit the like button if you on Facebook. Whatever emoji you feel like, hit the share button. I post a recipe to the syrup. Double tap on Instagram. Double tap on Instagram. Hit the subscribe button. Hit the subscribe button on YouTube. Yeah. I ought to be a damn shame. Why I ain't do this before? Why ain't nobody done this before? Popeyes. Serve me some daggone chicken in the waffle. Daggone it. Happy Tuesday, everybody. I am mad. Ain't nobody done this before. My God. My God.